successful wound management is predicated on being able to prognosticate around the wound. And prognostication as it relates to wounds is twofold. And as described by Hippocrates, prognosis, there's two forms of prognosis. One is quo ad sanantionem, which is essentially looking at the patient with the wound and assessing whether this wound will heal. And also, as per Hippocrates, quo ad vitam, what does that wound mean in terms of the patient's survival? Recent research is demonstrating that the presence of wounds is an independent prognostic factor. And it's not surprising, given the fact that wounds are essentially and metaphorically windows into people's health. So people with wounds are patients who are severely compromised, and a given patient may have other levels of organ failure, heart, renal, lung, liver, etc. But the skin, being the biggest organ, is also failing. And this is one of the main reasons why patients with advanced illness, namely those who get referred to palliative care programs, have such a huge burden of wounds. And in addition, and this is not a widely recognized piece of data, but actually, the cohort within healthcare that has the greatest incidence and prevalence of wounds is the advanced illness population that ultimately gets referred to palliative care.
Interesting.
It's been estimated that up to two-thirds of wounds worldwide occur in the very setting, namely the palliative care arena. Because patients are living longer with cancer and non-cancer diseases, and because wounds are the incidence and prevalence of wounds is proportionate to one's age, we're seeing more wounds overall. So we are seeing more wounds today than we did 50 years ago. And that includes malignant wounds. Decades ago, patients wouldn't reach so long in their disease trajectory as they are today. As a result of living longer with cancer, there's a greater propensity to develop malignant wounds. There's a greater propensity to develop leg ulcers, pressure ulcers, etc. So I think we need there has to be a bit of a catch-up process in terms of education and also advocacy and policy, etc. And we need to do it urgently because the management of wounds is consuming. It's actually one of the sectors within healthcare that's consuming, which is experiencing one of the greatest increases in overall expenditure. And most of it has to do with products. And again, that is part of the wound care phenomenon, namely, drug companies are developing products for wound care, not wound management. And given the fact that there's a real lack of comprehensive education around wounds, wound management namely, the low levels of educational proficiency in wound management is leading clinicians, both nursing and physician-wise, to focus on the product. In the United States, every year, there is a $15 billion expenditure on wound products alone. And I would offer to you that most of those expenditures are in vain, because the mere application of any given product is not a game breaker for the management of the wound. Not all wounds can be prevented. For instance, malignant wounds are a metastatic phenomenon, just like a metastasis to any other organ in the body. So, mind you, people with malignant wounds are living longer, and that's a testament to, you know, quantum improvements in oncologic care and disease modulating therapies that have occurred over the past several decades. 30 or 40 years ago, a patient with a malignant wound had a very reduced life expectancy. Today, a patient with a malignant wound the malignant wound has no effect on overall mortality. So, and that again is a testament to quantum improvements in disease modulating therapies. It is important to note that patients with advanced illness, cancer and non-cancer, they're fundamentally predisposed to the development of wounds, and particularly pressure ulcers. Pressure ulcers are the one category, the one class of wounds that is most prevalent and commonplace in patients with advanced illness. Again, both cancer and non-cancer, and it's related to decreasing performance status. Of all of the factors that predispose patients to the development of a pressure ulcer, it's a reduction in one's performance status when patients eventually become completely dependent and bedbound and not exhibiting spontaneous movements like a healthy person does, and also are developing other systemic failures like circulatory, pulmonary, cardiac, etc., associated organ failures. These are the this is the setting, this is the platform on which patients are predisposed to developing pressure ulcers, because ultimately a pressure ulcer is a form of what is called and coined skin failure, which is essentially an ischemic necrosis of the skin.